Francis was born in the late 1100s. He was born into a wealthy family. His father sold fabric, silk, and linen, and fine fabric and material all over the world. Francis was one of seven children. He was born into a life of privilege. He would never have had to go without. And he presumably was going to follow in his father's footsteps, join the family business, indeed, be a part of the family business throughout his life. And so he grew up in his day and age, like many young people do, just full of social events and sporting events and parties, and this lavish lifestyle impressed his friends with the great wealth that he had. And when he got to be a young man, he went off and fought in battle. And he was arrested and taken off as a prisoner of war, where he stayed in a prison for a year. When he got home, he returned very quickly back to his usual way of living, the sporting events, the parties, hanging out with friends, sparing no expense, living extravagantly. But a year after he was released from the prison, the military prison where he had been held captive, he had a grave illness that changed his life forever. It gave him a spiritual awakening. And he began to reevaluate everything in his life and began feeling that God was working in his midst and speaking to him and leading him in some way. Well, shortly thereafter, he began to live a life of seeking. One day he went and begged with those who were begging for alms in the square in front of St. Peter's Basilica in Rome, much to the chagrin of his dad, who was just infuriated that he would do such a thing. Well, a little later on, Francis was selling his father's fabric, his linen, his silk, in the marketplace. And on the way to where he was selling, he had a beggar come up to him and beg for alms, and Francis sent him away. I mean, he was there on his father's business, literally. He was there on a mission to sell out of everything that he had brought with him that particular day. But Francis could not shake the image of this beggar from his mind and his imagination. And so after he had sold out of everything, he went and found the beggar and emptied his pockets and gave him everything that he had, not only what he had brought, but what he had made that day. And his father once again was furious and began to threaten Francis, never again, never again. You're about my business, not about helping the poor. Well, one day Francis was praying in one of the parish churches around his hometown of Assisi, and he was there alone, and he was focusing on the image in front of the altar, which was a crucifix bearing the image of the crucified Christ. And he heard the voice of Jesus saying, Francis, you see my house is in disrepair. I want you to repair my house. Well, Francis took it quite literally, thinking that Jesus meant the physical chapel that he was sitting in, which was gravely in disrepair. And so Francis used the family business to sell the linen and the silk and then to make money to repair that chapel and two more. And by that point, his father had had enough. He insulted Francis. His insults turned to beating, and then beating turned to this public trial because Francis refused to recant or to change anything about his situation. And so there in front of the magistrates, in front of the whole gathered community that day, Francis renounced his heritage, his patronage, renounced the life that he had lived, literally stripped down naked, leaving the garments from his father's business aside and saying, I am now about my Father in heaven's business. And Francis, that moment, committed his life to doing God's work from there on out. Well, at first, Francis had one follower in 1 year, and then he found 11 others the next year, and one of them was a prominent townsperson who sold everything he had and gave it to the work of the cause to help live like Jesus in the world. Francis had a moment in his life that changed everything. He was listening to a sermon one day on Matthew chapter 10, verse 9, and this is what he heard. It says, go and proclaim that the kingdom of God has come near. Do not get any gold or silver or copper to take with you in your belts. Do not even take along a staff for your journey. And Francis heard in that call a call to go and move about as Jesus moved about, sending out disciples to proclaim the kingdom of God has come near, and helping others to live into that calling, to show others the tangible signs of God's kingdom in their midst. Now, Francis's life wasn't easy, but it did make a huge difference, and people today all over the world continue to follow him in the Franciscan order of being in a cloistered life, following Christ, living lives of poverty for the sake of the gospel. Well, there was one teaching that guided Francis's life more than any others, and it was this. He called it the primitive rule that he gets from the gospel. Follow the teachings of the Lord Jesus Christ and walk in his footsteps. Follow the teachings of the Lord Jesus Christ and walk in his footsteps. Francis said, my whole life and faith can be summed up according to this one primitive rule. And it's a rule that Franciscans follow still today. I think this is a great rule for us, all who are call ourselves Christians, little Christs, who seek to follow him faithfully with all of our lives. We want to not only know Christ's teachings, but we want to follow in his footsteps, to actually see the teachings lived out in our own lives. This season of Lent, we're working through a sermon series called Adulting, Developing a Mature Faith in Christ. It's up here on the circles, up here on the screens. And our goal is to learn, what does it look like to grow up in the faith? To move from being dependent on spiritual milk to eating meat, as Paul would say in his letters. How do we grow in the practices of the faith that help increase our dependence upon God and our faith to serve God by loving others? And that's what we hope to learn through this series. And what we're doing is focusing on our discipleship measures here at the Watershed, what we call life marks. We've looked so far at believing in God's salvation, studying God's word, and praying for God's leading. And this week we're going to learn about following Christ's teachings, knowing his teaching, and then following his teaching. And so just like last week, where we had the here is a football kind of moment in the sermon, we're going to get back to some basics here in order to go to a deeper place. And so I want to ask the question, how do we know Christ's teaching? How do we know Christ's teaching? Well, the here is the football moment is this. Scriptures are the obvious source for learning about what Christ is teaching us. That's the first place that we go. And we should study the word individually and with others who are gathered. But I myself am a hands-on learner. I learn when I put my whole body into something, when I integrate knowledge with practice. And it seems like Jesus was that way too, because he taught in a very particular way during his day and age. And so I think we know Christ's teaching not only by studying his word alone and with others, but we know Christ's teaching by watching others put it into practice. We follow others who are following Christ. And this has happened from generation upon generation upon generation, all the way back to the disciples who sat at the feet of Jesus. And we are here today because of others who transmitted and taught the faith to us, not probably by quoting scripture, although that may have worked, but by the way that they lived and how it was so compelling that we wanted to live that way too, and we wanted that kind of faith. And so we know Christ's teaching by reading the scriptures and by following others as they follow Christ. Well, what I want to do this morning is rewind all the way back to Luke's gospel. Because in Luke's gospel, we learn how Jesus called disciples and how he sent them out, how he taught them and then sent them and gathered them back in to teach them some more. And I want to show you this cycle because I think it's a good guide for us today. And so, how did Jesus call his disciples? Well, Jesus one day we see in Luke chapter 5, he was going to teach on the shore of the Lake of Gennesaret. And he just intended to stand there on the shoreline, and the terrain made it such that it was like an amphitheater where everybody could hear his voice. But it turned out the crowd was pressing in on him so much that Jesus needed to get out away from them a little bit. And so he turned aside to the left and to the right, and he realized that there were some fishermen who were standing by their boats washing their nets. They had just come in from a night of fishing, and it turns out they had fished all night but not caught anything at all. And so Jesus turns to one of the crews and says, can you put out your boat into the water so that I can teach the people who have gathered here? And so they reluctantly did. Now, I can imagine they wanted to go home after working the night shift, but they obliged this teacher who seemed to be drawing quite a crowd. And so they sat and listened as Jesus taught. And after his teaching, he said, all right, fishermen, what I want you to do now is I want you to put out your nets in the deep water. And they kind of laughed and said, Jesus, we are exhausted. We've been working all night. We have not caught anything. There are no fish in this body of water in this whole lake to catch today. They're all sleeping or they're somewhere else. But we'll do it just to prove that we're right and you're wrong. And so they did, and immediately their nets were so full of fish that they began to rip as they tried to pull the nets up into the boat. And it caught the attention of the other fishermen who were still completing the work of washing their nets and closing up for the night. And they hopped in their boat and came out and helped haul in the catch of fish. here's how they responded. When Simon Peter saw this, he fell at Jesus' knees and said, "Go away from me, Lord, I am a sinful man." For he and all of his companions were astonished at the catch of fish that they had taken. And so were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, Simon's partners. And then Jesus said to Simon, "Don't be afraid. From now on, you will fish for people." So they pulled their boats up on the shore, left everything, and followed Jesus. I love this teaching for a couple of reasons. One, the nets were bursting forth because there was such a catch. And as I look out throughout the congregation today, I can say that we metaphorically are part of that miraculous catch of fish that was bursting forth the nets this day. We are part of the people who are caught up in this teaching and message of Jesus Christ. We're sitting here today because followers of Christ in our generation or generations before cared enough to transmit the faith to us. But I also like this passage for another reason, and that's the disciples left everything to follow Jesus. For the sake of what they had learned, for the sake of the teaching, they left their livelihoods, they left their source of income, they left the security of their lives in order to follow this teacher with whom their future is unsecured and uncertain. But they were willing to place their faith and trust in Christ and give all for the sake of the gospel. Well, the next question is, well, what did the disciples see when they followed Jesus? What did they see? What did they learn? Well, we know reading from Luke 5 all the way through Luke chapter 9 what they saw. They saw Jesus healing the sick, casting out demons from people who had been demon-possessed for years or most of their lives. We see Jesus forgiving sins and being challenged by the religious leaders of his day, because who was he to forgive sins? We see Jesus raising the dead. We see many placing their faith and trust in Jesus as the one whom God had sent to reveal his glory to the world. We see all of this, and the disciples experienced it firsthand. They heard Jesus teaching what we call the Sermon on the Plain from Luke's Gospel, what Matthew calls the Sermon on the Mount. All of those things, blessed are those, the poor, for they will inherit the kingdom of God. They heard all of that. They heard what it was like to live life in the kingdom of God. Now, disciples know Christ's teaching, but Jesus was also, he was a hands-on kind of teacher. He says, it's not enough to just know with your head. I'm about practice. I'm about changing your life so that you can go and change others. And so what I'm going to do is gather you, and I'm going to send you out to put into practice everything that I have taught. And by the time we get to Luke chapter 9, this is what happened here. When Jesus had called the 12 together, he gave them power and authority to drive out all demons and to cure diseases. And he sent them out to proclaim the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. So they set out and went from village to village, proclaiming the good news and healing people everywhere. When the apostles returned, they reported to Jesus what they had done. Then he took them with him, and they withdrew by themselves to a town called Bethsaida. All right, so here's what's going on here. Jesus sends his disciples out to do the very things that they had watched him do up to this point, to heal diseases, to cure people of demon possession, to proclaim that the kingdom of God has come near. And you notice that the word is accompanied with action. Jesus was not just full of empty words that he had no intention of living out. He accompanied it with healing, with freedom. And he sent his disciples to do the same. It said he gave them authority to go and do those things. He sent them out, and then he gathered them back together. And they returned with great joy. They returned with great joy because they had done the work of God. They were accounted worthy of having God work through them. And it was amazing. So what can we learn from those who sat at the feet of Jesus and received his teaching? It's that the word is accompanied by action. That to whom much is given, much is expected. That Jesus wants us to go and proclaim the good news that the kingdom has come near, but actually back it up with actions that show the love that God has for the folks that we're preaching to. And this has serious implications for our lives. But we're sent, and then we gather back together in worship like this, to be refueled, to get our charge, and to go back out to do the work of God. So what happened when the people gathered? Well, they fed the multitudes. Jesus asked Peter, "Who do people say that I am?" And Peter proclaims, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus says, "If you want to be my disciples, you must take up your cross daily and follow me." Here's what happened next. He sends them out again, 72 this time, not just 12. See, they've gathered more people around them to go to do the work of God. And so Jesus said, "I'm sending the 72 out ahead of me into all the towns that I intend to go and preach." And then he told them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. Go, I am sending you as lambs among the wolves. When you enter a town and are welcomed, eat what is offered to you." And so between here and verse 17, it says, "Go and proclaim that the kingdom of God has come near, and heal those who are sick of their diseases." And the 72 returned with joy and said, "Lord, even the demons submit to us in your name." Joy. They returned with joy because they were accounted worthy of doing the work of God. And so we have this gathering and scattering, this being fueled and commissioned by God and being sent out into the world to do Christ's work and being gathered back in to be refueled and recentered and sent out. Jesus is a hands-on teacher who expects hands-on learners. It's not enough to just know something with our head, but we've got to know it with our heart and put our whole lives into following it. So it's not just about knowing Jesus' teachings, but it's about doing them. So here's the question. How do we as modern-day disciples know Christ's teaching? Well, again, the basic way is that we study the Scriptures alone and with others. We actually blow the dust off of our Bibles, we open up the book, and we read it. Okay, I know that's, here's football, right? It's very obvious, but we need to be in the Word of God every single day. I did college ministry at the beginning of my ministry vocation, and I had a student tell me one time, "I know everything there is to know about the Bible." And I went, "Woohoo, must be nice," right? I'd read through the Bible a couple of times at that point, but I never, even today, having studied it in seminary, could say I know everything there is to know about the Bible. And the reason is that it is living and active. Every time I read the same passage I might have read 10 or 20 times in my life, God has something new to reveal to me through that passage that speaks right into what I'm going through. And so maybe your Bible's dusty because you know everything about the Bible with your head, but are you living it out in your life? Blow the dust off of it. Read it. See how the Holy Spirit's going to speak to you through it. I guarantee God has a fresh word for you, a fresh revelation from the Word, if you will read it. We learn the Bible. We learn Jesus' teaching, as I said earlier, by following others who are following Christ. St. Francis and those before the Bible was written down in the language of the people would learn by going to worship and listening to sermons. And I pray that I would be able to preach one day as convicting as St. Francis heard, to cause him to change his life and to give everything for the sake of the gospel. But I think there's power in gathering as an assembly, as a group of Christians, and hearing the Word of God together and getting a charge and saying, "This day I commit to go forward and live differently." I think these are all ways that we come to know the teaching of Christ. Here's our next question. What does Jesus expect of us once we know his teaching? Now, we are modern day people. I realize that our lives are different than those first century Christians, but in a lot of ways they're not. These disciples left everything for the sake of the gospel. They left their nets, their livelihood, their security, everything to follow Jesus. And here in our day and age, in our culture, it's so hard to do that. You know, I've got a family to raise. I can't sell my home and go live on the streets. And, you know, I've got a job. I've got to make money to pay the bills. I'm in debt. I've got to pay off my debt. I'll do it when I retire. I mean, I hear all the time, I feel it as a pastor. I have my own reasons too for saying I can't leave everything. You don't mean everything, right, Jesus? You just mean I need to leave a little bit. Well, what are we going to do with what we've learned? There are ways to step into this. There are ways to be more faithful in not only knowing with our head, but putting this into practice with our lifestyle. And it's going to take sacrifice in order to have it happen. Jesus expects everything from us. To whom much is given, much is expected. Those of us who have learned the teachings of Christ now have the responsibility to do something with it and to put it into practice. It's not just words on a page. They're words written on our hearts so that we can live the Word of God. and point others to this kingdom that is coming. And who else is going to teach it if not us? Those disciples, those who have learned it from others, who have learned it from others, all the way back to the disciples in the time that Jesus walked this earth. But, dear friends, knowing Jesus is one thing, following Jesus is another. Let me put it this way. Knowing Jesus' teachings is one thing. Following them is quite another. You can have all of the head knowledge in the world. You can quote every scripture in the Old and New Testament. But if your life does not testify to those words, then it means nothing. The early church was really concerned about this. The letter of James that was written to the church in Jerusalem, James is the brother of Jesus. He was the leader of the Jerusalem church. He wrote to a church that struggled with this in the first century. These are folks who were with Jesus when he was alive and were part of planting the church after he was crucified, dead, and raised from the dead. These are folks who should have had every reason in the world to believe because they had had evidence right there in front of them. But yet they still struggled. And so James wrote these words to them. He says in James 1, beginning in verse 22, "Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like someone who looks at his face in the mirror and, after looking at himself, goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they have heard but doing it, they will be blessed in what they do." I don't know about you, but there are days that I do look in the mirror and want to forget what I look like, but it's impossible. I know what I look like, and I can glance in the mirror and know if there's a hair out of place or if there's something that I need to be tending to. Oh, look, there's chocolate on my face, right? I know what I look like. So James says that's an absurdity. And it's the same if you claim to know the Word of God, but you're not doing anything to put it into practice. But what I want to point out here in this passage is that this word continues in it. It carries forth the meaning of perseverance. Some translations say, if you look intently into the law that gives freedom and you persevere into it, you will be blessed in what you do. So why would James say that we have to persevere in following the teachings of Jesus? I think it's this, and it's very simple. The world is living differently than the way of God. And when we try to put our lives into living a different way, living Christ's way, it's not going to be easy. Because the world has every reason to keep us doing the same things that we've always done. Because nobody else really wants to change either. There's a lot at stake in having us put our faith and trust in God and living differently. It's convicting to people, and people don't like it. Now, they don't give it a lot of thought initially, but it's hard. I mean, try leaving a group of friends because Christ has got a hold of you and is sending you in a completely different direction. That's what we're talking about. That's what St. Francis experienced. He underwent intense persecution from his own dad, who intended for him to follow in his footsteps and to inherit the family business. Francis's friends made fun of him. "Why are you giving everything to the poor? Don't you realize what you've got? You've got the whole world at your feet. You've got everything that you could ever want. You'll never want for anything because your family is so wealthy. Why would you want to squander it all?" And Francis stopped going to these sporting events and to these big dinners and living the lavish life that he had once lived. And his friends would make fun of him. "Ha, ha, ha, are you married to the church or something?" And he would respond, "I'm married to Lady Poverty," which to him was this whole idea of giving all for the sake of the gospel. It wasn't easy. Not easy for us either. But here's the great irony of the faith. The very people who are making it hard for us to want to follow Jesus are the very ones for whom we're following him. Our hope and prayer is that God would dust us off, would put us on a path, and send us right back to those who are making things difficult so we can help bring about change in their lives through the gospel that's at work within us. That's the goal. It's all for the sake of love. But we have to do some hard things in the meantime in order to get there. And so James is on to something. It's hard to persevere in their particular case because the religious leaders had every reason to squash out Christianity before it could ever get going. And things haven't changed much there either. The world wants to squash out Christianity before it has the opportunity to change everything. We have to persevere, friends, in what we know and have been taught. Well, Jesus was also really concerned about this as well. And as he finished the Last Supper and was teaching his disciples before he was arrested in the garden, in John 14 and 15, he gives some really deep words that I want to share with you today, because he had the same concern that James was voicing after Jesus ascended into heaven. Jesus says, "If you love me, keep my commandments." So, obeying Christ's teachings, putting it into practice, is an act of love and devotion to Christ. So what does it say when we don't keep his commandments? We're not loving him, because loving is not a mental assent. It's a life lived in a certain way, devoted to Christ. He says, "If you love me, keep my commandments." And then in John 15, he goes on, "This is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love." It is again, "If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I've told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this." Okay, in case we wondered, what are the commands of Jesus? Here he is. "My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command." There's so much in this. So much in this. But Jesus knew that it was going to be easy to fall away. I mean, he even predicted to Simon Peter, "You are going to deny me three times this very night before the cock crows," even though we just shared this great supper together. And Peter says, "I will never deny you," and then went out and did it. Jesus knows it's going to be hard to stay the course, to remain faithful. He says, "Look, if you love me, keep my commandments." Now, how do we do this? How do we follow Christ's teachings? How do we keep his commandments? Jesus says, "By abiding in my love." Last summer, I preached a sermon series called "Who is Jesus?" And it was on the I am statements of Jesus. So who does he say that he is? And one of those was, "I am the vine and you are the branches." That's John 15. Jesus says that you abide in me as your source of life, and everything you need flows from that. And if you keep my commands, then you're abiding in me, and I will continue to provide everything that you need to stay the course. You see this? In John 14, right after what I read to you, he talks about the Holy Spirit being a constant presence in the lives of those who are abiding in him and keeping his commandments. See, for St. Francis, when he gave his life to following Christ, when he left everything, renounced his patronage, left his life of wealth and luxury behind, the Spirit gave him others to support his ministry, folks who were willing to give all to support it financially, people who left everything to follow and to create this movement. And the Spirit surrounded him with people that would keep him on the right track. This is what Jesus is talking about here in John 14. If you abide in his love, if you keep his commandments, the Holy Spirit will sustain you and strengthen you and continue to teach you everything that I have taught. John 14 would be a great thing to read after church today or this week. It's amazing. But we're promised the Spirit if we persevere in keeping Christ's commandments. But there's more. And I want to put the scripture back on the screen, because I just love what Jesus says here. "So if you keep my commands," he says, "you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. Greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for one's friends." We know Jesus is just about to do this. He's just about to lay down his life for his disciples and for us, by the way. But then look what he says here. "You are my friends when you do what I command. You are my friends if you do what I command." There's two things here. When we persevere in following Christ's teachings, we become friends with others as we transmit the faith to them, as we go forth and say the kingdom of God has come near, and actually do things in their midst that show that that's a real possibility. To show that God's intent is for others to be included in his family and in his household. It's actually doing things that make that promise manifest in somebody's life. It's bringing healing. It's bringing hope. It's bringing comfort. It's accompanying words with actions. And Jesus is saying that you become friends of others, true friends, by laying down your life for them. Look at Francis. He laid down his life so that the lepers who were neglected by the church in his day could be cared for and find their lives changed. Right? And he says that we are his friends when we do what he commands. Now, I don't know about you, but being friends of God sounds pretty awesome to me. And then making others friends of God seems like the most worthy calling in the entire world. And that's what Jesus says here. Become my friend by doing the things that I command, and then go and make friends with others by teaching them to do what I command. It's a richer life than anything that we could imagine before. But yet, it is so hard for us to actually do because it means giving up so much. And I don't know about you, but I hold on to so much in my life, and I say, Lord, I'll trust you with this much, but I don't want to trust you with this much. I'll take this step, but I don't want to take this step. And I wonder for myself, how much have I missed out on because I've been afraid to step out of the boat onto the water and trust Jesus to not let me fall? And I ask that question to all of you as well. Where can you trust him more? Where can you take a bigger step to actually put into practice what you know he's taught? Well, for Francis, he lived by this primitive rule that I lifted up earlier and called others to do that as well. He said, my rule, the rule of life that I've committed to from the gospel, is to follow the teaching of the Lord Jesus Christ and to walk in his footsteps. After all, that's what a disciple does. A disciple walks in the footsteps of the master, does what a disciple, what the master does, teaches what the master teaches. Well, we've inherited from John Wesley in the 1700s three simple rules that were based on this, and they have become a part of our church and are a part of who we are today. So here's how he would kind of expound on Francis's one. He would say, if you want to not only know the teachings of Christ, but live them out, do these three things. Do no harm, do good, stay in love with God. And I want to break these down just real quick as we bring this message to a close. So how do we put traction on this? How do we live this out as modern day disciples? Well, first, by doing no harm in our relationship with God or other people. Now, this is important. How do we do harm in our relationship with God? We neglect our relationship with him. We fail to pray. We fail to learn about his teachings by reading scripture. We don't follow and observe Sabbath rest, which I am really guilty of not doing. I'll confess to you right now, which shows that I don't trust God enough with all the stuff that I feel like needs to be done. It's all God's anyway. Right? But profaning the Sabbath is a way that we do harm to our relationship with God. How do we do harm in our relationship with others? Well, by gossiping, by talking badly about people behind their backs, by speaking words that do harm. You know, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words may never hurt me. They didn't know what they were talking about. Words wound deeply, and those wounds are long-lasting, right? What we say to people matters, and our words can do harm in somebody's life. And so we've got to watch out and measure everything we say as Christians with this gauge. Is this going to be helpful or harmful? And if it's going to be harmful, don't say it. Say a prayer to God instead that God would speak through you or speak to that person what they need to hear. Do no harm. That's a great way to begin to live out and follow the teachings of Christ as modern-day disciples. But the second is do good. Now, for many Christians, not doing harm is where we draw the line. We say, well, I didn't do anything wrong today. Praise Jesus, right? But to actually live out and obey the teachings of Christ, we have to intentionally take a step, take a risk, sacrifice ourselves in some way for the sake of faith to do something that Jesus would do if he were here and walking this earth today. Something like going and visiting in the prison, taking communion to somebody who's shut in, going to the hospital and seeing the sick, reconciling with somebody who has wrecked your life in your own opinion, asking to come over and laying it all out there and to say, I've forgiven you and I want to restore this relationship. Doing good, giving alms, going and serving the poor, going as Francis did out to where the lepers were and nursing them, going to the margins of society and preaching God's love. Doing good, not just saying, well, I didn't do wrong. I'm a good person because I don't do bad things, right? We all sin and fall short of the glory of God, so we know that that's not right. And we know that we're not saved by our works, but we do know that a life of faith takes risk to live it out, and that our works show the fruit of the faith that is active in our lives. So do no harm, do good. The third is stay in love with God. You know, staying in love with God requires some things of us, and this is where it gets a little bit messy. We stay in love with God by not neglecting the Lord's Supper. We stay in love with God by praying daily, by studying God's Word, individually and with other people. We stay in love with God by making worship a priority every single week and not making excuses for not attending Bible study or not attending worship. What are we teaching our children when we don't make the most important part of our lives, our relationship with God, first and foremost? What is that communicating? Don't be surprised when they graduate from high school and don't set foot into a church. Because we're showing, well, we go when we feel like it, right? That's not what it's all about. You stay in love with God by attending to the ordinances of God, by attending to the faith that you have. You do it by serving and by not neglecting the needs of one another. That's how we stay in love with God. John Wesley says, if you do no harm, you do good, you stay in love with God, you're going to put the teachings of Christ in effect in your life. So, as we close, let's go back to Francis. Francis's life changed the world because he was willing to leave everything for the sake of the gospel, to actually believe in what Jesus taught so deeply that he was willing to commit his life to following. And now we've got Franciscan orders all over the world, people who have modeled their lives after the life of Francis, who have subjugated themselves of everything in the world and committed to a life of poverty in order to make the gospel known on the margins of society. So I want to leave you with this. This is what's at stake by not just knowing Jesus' words with your head, but actually putting them into practice in your life. What is the legacy that you're leaving behind for your children, your grandchildren, the generations that are coming after you? Is your life a life of accommodation? I'll get to faith when I feel like it. Or is your life speaking, I'm willing to sacrifice everything so that others can know Jesus and the world can be changed into what God intended for it to be all along? If you're not living that way, what's it going to take to get there? To move from just knowing to living it out, to following Christ's teaching? My prayer for all of us is that we would be world changers, people who truly trust in God so much that we're willing to do what God asks us to do. So I pray that you would begin to reflect on what legacy you're leaving behind. Start right now, today. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, let us pray. Jesus, we thank you for what you've taught us. We thank you that you weren't just a man of empty words, but you were a man of action. You truly believed that God was wanting to change the world through this crazy organization of people called church. And so, Lord, we thank you for giving us your commands, for sustaining us with your Holy Spirit, for calling us outside our comfort zones to the margins to proclaim that the kingdom of heaven has come near, to actually back it up with actions. Lord, help us as we go throughout our daily lives to realize that faith is not just something that's for us personally. It's important to have a personal relationship with Christ, but faith is meant to be shared, Lord. So give us the courage to testify in our workplaces, at the grocery store, at the bleachers at the soccer field, in our homes, that the kingdom of heaven has come near, and to bring healing and hope into the midst of brokenness and despair. Lord, I know some of us today are living in places of hopelessness or despair, and I pray that you would make yourself known, bring your comfort, your healing, and your peace into the lives of all of those who need it this day. But instill, even in the midst of that, a sense of greater purpose, and that's knowing you, but also making you known. So Lord, give us the courage to face the future unafraid and to share your love and your life with all who will listen until our last breath here on this earth. Help us, Lord, to make you known. We love you, God. We trust you, and we pray all this in the name of the one who taught us to pray this prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.